Hi everyone, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today. Just giving everyone a couple seconds to join us and get logged into the room. For those of you who might not have heard, my name is Amelia Friedman and I'm a staff attorney with CELA, which is the Children's Immigration Law Academy. We are here today for a 1 hour webinar on pro bono representation of unaccompanied children in immigration matters. The panelists today will be myself, along with my colleagues from CELA, Laura Egan and Sachi Denham Hand. As I said, this will be a 1 hour webinar. It is being recorded. There were also some materials circulated in advance of the webinar. I emailed out copies of the slides as well as a handout with some information about how to get involved and some helpful links. I will also be sending copies of those again to the attendees after. So if you didn't receive them, you will hopefully receive them after the webinar. We also ask that you use the Q&A function on the webinar. If you do have any questions throughout this presentation, we will be leaving some time at the end to answer them. We are going to be going over today first a little bit about CELA, then we'll be talking about who is an unaccompanied child. We're going to go over a little bit about the immigration court proceedings, common forms of relief for children, how to get involved, and then how to stay in touch with us, which we hope all of you will. CELA, as I mentioned, stands for the Children's Immigration Law Academy. We are a project of the American Bar Association's Commission on Immigration. We're also an expert legal resource center, which means we provide trainings like this one, webinars, as well as some other trainings that are, for the most part, recorded, and many of them are available on our website. We are a capacity building organization, and we think that every child should have representation. CELA services, in addition to trainings like this, include a number of written resources that are available online. We also provide technical assistance for legal services providers, as well as pro bono attorneys. And we encourage everyone to reach out to us if you have a children's immigration case with any question, whether it be basic or something specific, and we'll do our best to try and assist you. We facilitate working groups on a number of topics in the field, such as asylum or special immigrant juvenile status, which are two forms of relief we'll be talking about today. And those are both, some of them are Texas specific, most of them now are nationwide. And we also have a pro bono initiatives program like that facilitates trainings like this and also provides some models and other support for pro bono work. And we're very proud to say that we have two social workers on staff and they have a social work program that provides resources as well as technical assistance if there are specific questions that might be more on the social work side than the legal side relating to some of these cases. This is one of our resources that's available online. It's called the Pro Bono Guide. It is a pretty comprehensive resource and we encourage you to review it if you are involved in this line of work or interested in getting involved. It will be included in the links and the materials in the handout that I circulated before the webinar and will be circulating again. And in addition, as I mentioned, there's a number of free webinars on our website for one-on-one trainings, as well as access to some more advanced trainings. And we encourage you to check those out. So I'm gonna get started now about talking a little bit more about who is an unaccompanied child. And the legal definition of an unaccompanied child is someone who is under the age of 18 years and has no lawful immigration status when they enter the United States and is not accompanied by a parent or a legal guardian in the United States who is available to provide care and physical custody. I will note that while this is the legal definition, it is typically an assessment that is made at the time the child crosses the border. So it is certainly possible that if you do take a case with a child who has been designated as an unaccompanied child, by the time you work with them, they've been released from a shelter and are now living somewhere in the United States. They very well may be living with a legal guardian or have some support and living with family at that point. We also wanted to highlight a little bit about the reasons why children come to the United States unaccompanied. This is a really interesting chart that was prepared by the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, UNHCR. And as you can see, it really shows how there's a number of overlapping reasons and that in many cases, it's a multifaceted kind of issue and that there are oftentimes multiple reasons why children leave their home to come to the United States unaccompanied. And many times too, if you're working with a child, it's quite possible that they will have talked about one issue to begin with, and then you'll learn later that there was another issue as well. The root crisis, these root causes of migration are complicated and they span a bunch of different issues. In addition, every child's story is unique, and it's always important to keep that in mind when working with children in this area. The slide also includes a link if you would like to read more about this and kind of a little bit more about the study that was done to generate this data by UNHCR. This is some additional data about where migrant children come from. And as you can see, most of the children who are considered unaccompanied children in the United States are coming from Central American countries, Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador. Although certainly that's not the case that they all come from there. In fact, if you kind of look at the bottom row, you can see there's actually been an increase in children coming from other parts of the world over the years. This is some data about the numbers of unaccompanied children, and it unfortunately is a very high number. It was over 100,000 last year, and just based on the data that's been tracked in the beginning quarter of this year, it is unfortunately looking like that may be the case again this year. This is one of the reasons why we feel very strongly about trying to encourage pro bono initiatives and encourage people to take these cases, because there really is a lot of work to be done in this area and a lot of children who need help. This slide is highlighting some of the unique legal protections that are available for unaccompanied children, kind of like an explanation for one of the reasons why it's important to know whether or not a child that you're working with has been designated as an unaccompanied child. There was a settlement agreement in the 1980s called the Flores Settlement Agreement, which created some protections for children that was focused specifically about how they are detained when they arrived in the United States, including who oversees that process and the types of facilities that the children are required to be placed in. There were also a couple of statutes highlighted on this slide, the Homeland Security Act of 2002 and the Trafficking Victims Protection Reauthorization Act, which stands for the TVPRA. And those include some additional legal protections. We're gonna be talking a little bit about some of the protections in there in some of the later slides, but it's really just important to keep in mind that unaccompanied children do have some unique legal protections apply through them throughout the immigration process. And with that, I'm going to turn it over now to my colleague, Laura, who's gonna talk a little bit more about immigration court.
Thank you so much, Amelia, appreciate that. Yeah, so we're gonna spend some time talking about removal proceedings in immigration court. And to get started, it's really helpful to have an understanding of the process that unaccompanied children go through upon entering the United States. There are a lot of agencies involved. So I included a list here of some of the key agencies. There's also a flow chart, so you can go back to this slide as a reference and kind of zoom in on the flow chart, because it gives a good representation of the processes. But just to give an overview of that, the typical flow and procedures unaccompanied children face, you know, usually this starts with CBP, Customs and Border Protection, with apprehension at the border. So if the unaccompanied child is coming from a contiguous country, Canada or Mexico, then they're going to be doing a screening for trafficking, persecution, and many are sent voluntarily home. But if it is not a contiguous country, then the child should be transported within 72 hours to the Office of Refugee Resettlement. This is under the Department of Health and Human Services, or HHS. And so there at ORR, those are shelters for the unaccompanied children, and their job, one of their primary responsibilities, is to work to place the child with a sponsor, that being a close family friend or family member, and most children are able to reunify with a sponsor. At the same time, the children will be going through removal proceedings, so the immigration court process, and like I said, we'll get into that further. But it's just important to, again, to see that many times these processes are happening all at once. So these issues are complicated, and just at the forefront, we want to note that many times children are navigating these processes without representation, without counsel. While children and adults have the right to counsel in removal proceedings, they do not have appointed counsel. So that's an important distinction. And as you can imagine, you know, if the child is unaccompanied, then they're going to be having to find that counsel likely on their own. And there is a large network of nonprofit organizations that do this work across the country, but there's not enough capacity to represent all unaccompanied children. And so there's a pretty big gap. And that's why there's a need for pro bono representation to fill that gap. But at this point, that gap is significant. And so the data here is from the immigration court itself regarding pending unaccompanied children's cases in immigration court. And it does show that there's thousands of children without representation. Approximately half of kids, just under half of kids, don't have counsel while in immigration court. Immigration court is an administrative department of the Executive Office for Immigration Review, or EOIR, and that's a branch of the Department of Justice under Article 2, the executive branch. There are approximately 600 immigration judges and 68 immigration courts nationwide. And the immigration courts are not Article 3 courts. They are administrative judges hired by the DOJ. They're not elected like some state judges or appointed and confirmed by Congress like some federal judges. Their powers and authority are delegated by the Attorney General and limited by their regulations. It's also not an Article 1 court, which is what most administrative courts are, like tax court, for example. So because of this, immigration court is more influenced by politics because it's under the executive branch. And this is why many professional organizations, including the American Bar Association, as well as the National Association of Immigration Judges, have lobbied for a more independent structure. So we're going over some more differences about immigration court. You know, in immigration court, the federal rules of evidence are not binding. Although they can provide some guidance, so you can still point to them if it's useful. And instead, the test for admission of evidence is relevance and fundamental fairness. So judges then determine what weight to give evidence, how much they're going to rely on it. An immigration judge has pretty broad discretion to accept and assign that evidentiary weight to pieces of evidence. In an immigration court, rules are governed by the Immigration and Nationality Act, regulations and case law, and also procedural rules are included in the Immigration Court Practice Manual. And sometimes there's other local rules by the specific immigration judge. I did link to the Immigration Court Practice Manual here on this slide as well, because again, it's an important document to access and look through when working on a case. So just to get more into removal proceedings begin when the charging document, a notice to appear, or for short, an NTA, is filed with the immigration court by the Department of Homeland Security after it's been served on the individual in proceedings. And generally that NTA is a charging document that goes over the charges against the individual, why they are in immigration court. It includes identifying information, factual allegations, the specific charges, and proof of service. And so in immigration proceedings, the judge is going to consider any relief that the individual files, or if they're seeking other relief, they're going to get status updates on that. And they're ultimately going to make a decision in the case, you know, to grant relief, voluntary departure, order of removal, dismissal, whatever the case may be. And on this slide, we show just a picture of kind of like your average immigration court. What will it look like? And, you know, each room does, you know, vary to some extent, but this is a pretty traditional average immigration court. And so at the center at the desk, usually that's where the immigration judge is going to sit, the IJ for short. And then there's going to be a couple of desks to the side of them. And usually at one of those desks is an assistant or clerk to the judge. Sometimes at the other desks, you know, maybe that's where somebody sits on the stand to provide testimony, or maybe the interpreter is sitting there. And then there's two desks facing the judge. And so usually at one of those desks is hopefully an attorney with the respondent, that's your client. And then at the other desk, there's going to be counsel for the government. So that from the Department of Homeland Security, Office of the Principal Legal Advisor, or OPLA attorney for short, that's your opposing counsel. And I will note for the interpreter, you know, that it's going to be somebody that's provided at government expense. And sometimes they're in person, sometimes they're on the phone, but they should be providing interpretation for your client's best language. You also see the gallery because these cases are typically open to the public. And so as other people have other cases that will be heard, that's where these individuals sit as well. So I'm going to cover two primary forms of hearings that occur in immigration court: master calendar hearings and individual calendar hearings. There are also bond hearings in immigration court, but these relate mostly to adults, so I'm going to not go over those today. So master calendar hearings are more preliminary in nature. They're typically run on a docket, so many cases are scheduled at one time, and you might be waiting, and then your case is pretty short and going over again, the procedural matters. You might be taking pleadings, going over that notice to appear, filing any applications or petitions, and then scheduling your next court date. Now, I will note that there has been some push to get away from these master calendar hearings and not do them as frequently, to do more just via the documents themselves rather than in court. A lot of times that hasn't affected children's cases, but it's still just important to be aware of that. I'll also just note, while these are, you know, usually about procedural matters, they are very important because they're kind of setting out the course for that particular case. And also, a judge can order somebody's removal at a master calendar hearing if you're not prepared or if there's no leave to be filed. So it's just important to take them seriously. The individual calendar hearing is different in that it's a specific date and time for that specific individual. And immigration attorneys often call this a mini trial, because it really is when your client has their day in court, when you're presenting the case, you're making arguments. Many times the client will testify, you'll have other witnesses potentially, and then the judge will be making a decision. For those decisions, oftentimes they are oral decisions, or the judge could issue a decision in writing. That just depends. I'll also say, you know, sometimes hearings are scheduled for a second date if they need more time to get a particular piece of evidence that the judge wants to see, or if you need to get more time for testimony from witnesses, or maybe even just for the decision itself. So it depends per case, but quite often it all finishes that one day. I'll also just know, in terms of testimony, you know, like I said, many times clients will testify and they'll do the direct examination, be subject to cross-examination, and just to note that immigration judges can question your clients as well. That's very common in immigration court. Hearings can also be held in person via VTC, video teleconference, or internet-based hearings, is what they're calling it. And that's via WebEx. That's the technology that the immigration court uses. And hearings can also be done by phone. Now, this has always been the case, these three kind of formats. But as you can imagine, with the pandemic, there has been an increase in remote proceedings. And the EYR website does provide a list of states and particular immigration courts, and within that, particular immigration judges, of what the default format will be for their proceedings, which is really helpful. And that's online. And I have a picture here so you can access that easily. CELA last year also created a resource on tips for working with children and youth remotely in a hearing or USCIS asylum office interview. And because there's a lot of considerations involved when thinking about having a remote proceeding. And so I'd suggest, you know, going to that or reaching out to us if you're interested in learning more, because we can't get into all those considerations today. I'll say that children's cases in immigration court go through the court process in largely the same way that adults' cases go through immigration court. There's not a lot of differences, but there is some guidance for how judges should handle cases involving children. And much of that guidance is in the Operating Policy and Procedures Memorandum, OPPM 1703. And so there's a picture of that on this slide. I will note that there are some negative aspects to this document, as well as some positive aspects to this document. So it's worth reviewing in total. But this slide highlights some of the key aspects that are positive. So if an advocate wanted to point to something to say, you know, look, we should have questioning that's using age-appropriate language, or we need to have additional breaks, this is the case of a child, then this is some place that you can point to for that support. There's also some information regarding juveniles' proceedings in the Immigration Court Practice Manual, which is also linked on this slide. I'll also note There's a director's memorandum on encouraging and facilitating pro bono legal services, DM 2201, which includes facilitating pro bono representation for children respondents, and reiterates using child-sensitive questioning. So that is available online to review. So that's another source you can point to as further support that the fact that these are children's cases, there are some special considerations to be involved. And that memorandum issued, you know, relatively recently in 2021. And now we want to just go ahead and highlight and flag some ethical consideration. So when working with children, there are some ethical considerations that are particularly important to remember. And we don't have time to get into it fully today, but we do want to, like I say, highlight or flag these. So capacity might be diminished of your client because of their age, potentially. But it's really important to remember that the ABA model professional conduct indicates that in that situation, a lawyer should as much as possible maintain a normal client-attorney relationship. So that's really the starting point. Also, there's an issue regarding stated interest versus best interest. As the attorney, we must represent the child's expressed wishes, their stated interest. So it's your job to know what that is, to talk with them about it. What do they want to ask? And I think this is important to remember because there's just an innate power differential between an attorney and client, and also between an adult and a child. And so it's important to keep at the forefront of your mind, you know, that this is the child's case, this is their life. So it's your job really to follow what they want to do and what they're looking for. Also, just to be aware of that state laws differ on what you must do to report child abuse or neglect. So it's important to know your particular state laws. Put a quotation citation from Texas because we're based in Texas, and Texas is a mandatory reporting state even for attorneys. So it's something, you know, that must be talked through with your client about at the beginning. This next slide we've included here as a reference, it really goes over some of the key forms of relief for humanitarian protection and immigration proceedings. And so this is really here for you to kind of look through and be familiar with if it's helpful to you. But we're going to spend more focused time on the two common forms of relief for children's cases, asylum and special immigrant juvenile status, or SIJS. So those are the two most common forms of humanitarian protection that unaccompanied children seek. And so I'm gonna turn it over to my colleague, Sachi, to go over that.
Thank you, Laura. On that note, we're going to turn to the two most common forms of humanitarian relief available to unaccompanied children, asylum and SIJS, and we will begin by discussing asylum. The definition of asylum is housed in the Immigration and Nationality Act, the INA, and the definition itself is derived from international law via the 1951 Refugee Convention. Per the INA, an individual is eligible for asylum if they meet the definition of a refugee. Now, the term refugee is not interchangeable with the term asylee, and the difference is that a refugee is designated as such outside of the United States, while an asylee is designated inside the United States. However, still, an individual is eligible for asylum by meeting the definition of a refugee. Here we've broken down that definition of refugee on the slide, and a refugee is a person who is unable or unwilling to return to their country or avail themselves of the country's protection because they have suffered either past persecution or they possess a well-founded fear of future persecution on account of five protected grounds: race, religion, nationality, political opinion, which can be affirmative or imputed on the individual, or particular social group called a PSG. PSGs are the most common protected ground that appear in children's asylum cases. So we will get into those a little bit separately a little bit later. Now, if you are familiar with asylum and adult cases, you may have an understanding of rules that are applicable for when adults apply for asylum. However, there are special rules and exemptions for unaccompanied children who apply for asylum. And we have those listed here on the screen. First, unaccompanied children are exempt from the one-year filing deadline for asylum. Most asylum applicants must apply for asylum within 1 year of their latest entry into the United States. However, again, unaccompanied children are exempt from this 1 year deadline to file. Second, unaccompanied children are exempt from the safe third country rule. There is a principle that often justifies the decision to return asylum seekers to another country or to reject their asylum applications. A country such as the United States can reject a person's asylum application if they have already been granted protection by another country, such as a country that they passed through on their way to the United States. This concept is often referred to as the safe third country principle, and unaccompanied children are exempt from it. Third, and very importantly, unaccompanied children have the opportunity to present their case in a non-adversarial setting. This means that unaccompanied children's asylum cases are heard in the first instance by United States Citizenship and Immigration Services, USCIS, asylum officer at the USCIS asylum office instead of at a contested merits hearing before the immigration judge, the IJ. This is a significant protection afforded by the TVPRA, and this is even the case when a child has a defensive asylum application because they are in removal proceedings. They will still have the opportunity for a non-adversarial hearing. However, this does get kind of tricky sometimes. Touching on that issue of the non-adversarial setting and USCIS having initial jurisdiction over unaccompanied children's asylum cases, sometimes the issue does arise, especially when a child turns 18, of whether the asylum claim should be before USCIS, the non-adversarial setting, or EOIR, the considered adversarial setting. On this note, we do want to share a resource that touches on the issue of initial jurisdiction over children's asylum cases. This resource is from NIP-NLG, and it goes over navigating children's asylum cases in immigration court in light of the case JOP versus the Department of Homeland Security, which is a pending class action suit challenging a Trump administration policy limiting the ability for certain unaccompanied children to seek asylum. To note on that JOP case, the injunction resulting from the case is still in place as the case is pending. The JOP injunction requires USCIS to accept jurisdiction over unaccompanied children's asylum cases if the cases meet the criteria outlined in USCIS's 2013 jurisdictional policy. We're going to go back to the five protected grounds and PSGs. As I said earlier, we do want to discuss PSGs because they frequently appear in the context of children's asylum cases. As mentioned before, asylum eligibility requires either past persecution or possession of a well-founded fear of persecution on account of five protected grounds, one of those being a particular social group or PSG. Generally and very broadly speaking, a PSG is composed of persons of similar background, social status, lineage, experiences, or habits. PSGs that are commonly used in children's cases are based in familial status or familial membership, domestic violence claims, gender-based claims, and gang-based claims. An asylum claim with persecution on account of a PSG may look or sound like, for example, this person was persecuted due to their membership in X family, just as an example. Practitioners can get creative with formulating PSGs and assessing why their client was persecuted. However, at the same time, PSGs do have to follow a number of characteristics based on precedent of particularity, immutability, and distinction, among other things. Now, a child's case can bring forth a novel or new PSG that has not yet been addressed by the asylum office, but it is important to note that asylum officers generally have very limited ability or discretion to grant novel PSGs. Novel PSGs must be approved by headquarters. In gang-based claims, just a note on those, gang-based PSGs frequently appear in children's cases, as gang violence is pervasive in many of the countries from which the youth flee, and many youths experience persecution or fear of persecution due to gangs. However, gang-based claims may be difficult to bring forward, though they are not impossible to do so. We encourage you to read decisions and case law from your circuit and the Board of Immigration Appeals, the BIA, to see specific examples of PSGs that are often accepted or applied. Additionally, while PSGs are a common protected ground in children's asylum cases, don't forget about the other four protected grounds that may also be applicable to your set of facts. are granted special protections from multiple sources that can be utilized throughout the course of a child's asylum case. On this slide, we've linked some notable ones involving child-specific guidelines from the UNHCR. They publish guidance on child-specific forms of persecution that may give rise to a child's claim for refugee protection. Additionally, this guidance discusses that children have inherent vulnerabilities that mandate additional safeguards as these children move through the asylum process. From the asylum office itself, there's actually a training module for USCIS officers available on the slide that provides guidance and guidelines for adjudicating children's asylum claims. Issues that are addressed in this training module include guidelines for child-sensitive interview techniques, child development, procedural issues, and considerations for the legal analysis of claims involving child applicants. EOIR publishes memoranda and guidance involving issues in immigration cases, and the one on the slide provides guidance for adjudicating cases involving any unmarried individual under age 18, including as both respondents and as third-party witnesses. And additionally, when you are representing a child in proceedings or in their asylum case, there are special considerations in presenting their testimony or evidence, such as the impact of their age, their credibility, their ability to corroborate, and their capacity. And there may be additional safeguards to consider for child clients in proceedings or with asylum cases. Next slide, please. Now, it's very understandable, I think, that children's asylum cases often bring up trauma that these children experienced prior to coming to the United States. Asylum cases, after all, are based in persecution or fear of future persecution. So it is important to engage in trauma-informed advocacy and lawyering when working on a child's asylum case or really any type of child's immigration case. While many definitions exist for trauma-informed care, generally, it is an approach for client interaction that recognizes trauma, creates a safe space for communication and collaboration with the client while empowering them, and seeks to prevent re-traumatization of the client. We at CELA develop resources, and we have two CELA resources that will assist attorneys with trauma-informed practice in children's asylum cases. One is a hearing or interview checklist, things to keep in mind for trauma-informed representation in asylum cases. And the other is a tip sheet that discusses the concept of trauma-informed lawyering in addition to navigating certain topics or issues with child clients while maintaining a safe space with them. We created the tip sheet for new children's immigration attorneys and pro bono attorneys working on children's cases. And this resource can also provide reminders and tips for those who are already practicing. Both of these resources are linked here on the slide, but they're also on our website under our additional resources page. And the password is CELA Help in all capital letters. You can also email us to gain access to this page if you forget the password and to check out other resources. Now that wraps up asylum, but we're going to go over the other common form of immigration relief for children. And it is called Special Immigrant Juvenile Status, SIJS or SIJS. And this relief is specifically for children. And if you are new to this work, you may not have heard of it before. SIJS is a form of legal relief that is available to children who have been abused, abandoned, or neglected by one or both parents. And this form of legal relief provides a pathway to obtain lawful immigration status. Who qualifies for SIJS? Well, when SIJS was first created, it only benefited those who were in the long-term foster care system. But now children in the state foster care system, in custody of ORR, those living with a non-parent relative, and those living with one parent can qualify for SIJS. SIJS is a three-step process, which I will go over later, but after the SIJS petition, the form I-360 is approved and SIJS status granted, the beneficiary will wait for a visa to become available and then apply to adjust status to lawful permanent residency status when the visa is available. And the time that they are waiting to apply for adjustment of status, USCIS may grant the beneficiary deferred action, which lasts for 4 years, is renewable, and gives a basis for SIJS beneficiaries to apply for work authorization while they wait for a visa availability. The SIJS authorities are the INA and federal regulations. The INA defines a special immigrant juvenile lists the Department of Homeland Security consent function, which is that DHS must consent to grant SIJS, and further lists that parents cannot benefit from their child's SIJ status. The SIJS regulations were updated in spring 2022, and they list the eligibility for the SIJS petitioner, in addition to listing specific definitions relating to the proceedings and the SIJS process. Also listed here is the USCIS Policy Manual on SIJS, and Volume 6, Part J of the Policy Manual, available on USCIS's website, encompasses all things SIJS, including the purpose and background, the legal authorities, the eligibility requirements, and the adjudication of SIJS. We do recommend that attorneys working with unaccompanied children on SIJS cases should become familiar with and consistently reference the policy manual when working these cases. I'm now going to go over the SIJS eligibility requirements housed in the regulations and updated in 2022. First, the petitioner must be physically present in the United States at the time of filing and through adjudication of the SIJS petition, which is USCIS Form I-360 Petition for SIJS. The petitioner must be unmarried through adjudication of the SIJS petition, the Form I-360. This was changed in 2022. Previously, the petitioner had to be unmarried through adjudication of the application for AOS, Adjustment of Status. The petitioner must be under 21 on the date of filing the SIJ petition, the Form I-360. The petitioner must submit a valid juvenile court order with certain judicial determinations, which we will go over later, and DHS must consent, verifying that the request is bona fide. As I said earlier, SIJS is a three-step process. The first step is that the petitioner must obtain the state court order with certain judicial determinations. The second step is to petition for SIJS with USCIS by submitting that Form I-360 and submitting the state court order with the determinations along with the petition. And the third step is if USCIS grants SIJS to the petitioner, then the petitioner is given a priority date. And this will indicate whether a visa is available for the petitioner to adjust status to lawful permanent residency status. When their priority date is current, indicating that a visa is available, the SIJS beneficiary can then apply for lawful permanent residency status with the Form I-485. This slide takes a closer look at that first step of SIJS and the five key elements of that first step. In sum, to demonstrate SIJS eligibility, the first step is that the petitioner must obtain a state court order that sets out the eligibility requirements. Then the state court order must be submitted to USCIS with the petition for SIJS, the Form I-360. The five things to remember with the state court order process is that the state court order must be a valid state court order with certain judicial determinations. The first judicial determination required by the regulations and USCIS is that the state court order have jurisdiction under state law over the custody or dependency and care of the youth. The second judicial determination required under the immigration regulations deals with parental reunification. The third determination listed in the regulations is that it would not be in the youth's best interest to return to their or their parents' country of nationality or last habitual residence, which in many cases will be the child's previous placement. And finally, USCIS must consent or approve the SIJS after the state court order is submitted with the SIJS petition. So this slide addresses simultaneous proceedings in SIJS cases. And although we would prefer that one step follow the next, a child may be involved in simultaneous proceedings. By that, I mean that a child may have a case at the state court while they are removal proceedings with the immigration court, or the child may have a pending case with USCIS while still being in removal proceedings with the immigration court. And the child may need to attend removal proceedings at immigration court if a notice to appear document, an NTA, was filed with the immigration court. If that's the case, the child and the attorney will attend several master calendar hearings where they will keep the judge informed about the progress of their case. In time, while they are in the removal proceedings, as part of the SIJS process and going through the first step, they may have state court proceedings to obtain that state court order. And once the state court order is actually obtained, the child will then need to file the SIJS petition, the Form I-360 with USCIS, which means they will then have a pending case with USCIS. So these things overlap. At the master calendar hearing, the attorney can give the judge updates about the SIJS case, letting the judge know that the state court order has been obtained or that the petition has been filed with USCIS. Now, when it is time to adjust to lawful permanent resident status, the third step of the SIJA process, it may look different depending on whether or not the child is in removal proceedings. For example, if a child is in removal proceedings, then they need to wait until the petition, the Form I-360, is approved before moving forward on adjusting their status. Then the child may seek dismissal of their removal proceedings to file their lawful permanent residency application either before USCIS, or they can proceed with their adjustment application before the immigration court. However, if the child is not in removal proceedings and they have a current priority date indicating that a visa is available, then the application to adjust status with the I-485 may be filed simultaneously. And if a child is designated as an arriving alien, they will need to adjust before USCIS, even if removal proceedings have not yet been dismissed. I know that was a lot of information about simultaneous proceedings, and truthfully, there are more nuances and intricacies to it. However, here is a more in-depth look at those simultaneous proceedings. This is a great graphic about what it looks like in an SIJS case. So this is to have for your reference and for you to take a closer look at when you get these slides. I'll turn it back now to my colleague, Amelia. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Sachi, and thank you, Laura, for that great overview. I am going to turn us now to talking a little bit more about some tangible and practical ways that you can get involved. I will say what we've tried to do in these last couple sections is provide kind of an overview of the type of work. And as you can see, it can be pretty complicated. It can touch on courtroom. It can involve interviews. It can involve writing. It can involve conversations with the client. It also can touch different types of courtroom processes and agencies. So there's a lot of different ways that these cases can look and can involve in different types of pieces. I will also share just on a somewhat personal note, I know that at times, sometimes this world can feel a little overwhelming, even for lawyers, because it can feel like a very foreign and different area, but I hope that folks don't feel discouraged by that. And actually, as somebody who has spent some time working in other areas of the law and done pro bono immigration cases, these can be very rewarding cases working with the children. And also you can really see the tangible impact that your work can have on this area if you take the case, because as Laura mentioned, many of the children, if they don't have pro bono representation, will end up just having to represent themselves in a very complicated process and without having kind of even the level of skills that many practitioners already have, just in terms of understanding processes and writing and research and understanding a little bit more about how to ask for relief and things to look at. So with that in mind, I'm gonna just turn to some ways, if you're interested in learning more or potentially thinking about taking a case, which we hope everybody will do, a good starting point, if you don't know where to look, is actually a platform that we hosts on our website. It's called the Pro Bono Matters for Children Facing Deportation. And it is kind of a depository where a bunch of different organizations that we work with across the country place their cases online, and it's a place where you can kind of sift through and look at it. And I'll go on through a little more detail about that, where that is. And it's kind of CELA's connecting folks in terms of, we don't necessarily do the direct mentorship ourselves, but we are connecting people who are interested with the organizations we work with. And certainly if you have a pro bono case, like I mentioned, you're welcome to reach out to CELA directly for technical assistance on that case. I will just say now too, if you do have any questions, we are gonna have a little bit of time to address those at the end. So please feel free to put those in the Q&A and we'll try to address those after I kind of talk a little bit more about the platform. So this is a list of some of the organizations that we partner with on this platform. And as you can see, it's a pretty large group. They're also all over the country, which is great. They tend to be focused in areas where there is a higher population of unaccompanied children. And if you do live in a place where, like a state where one of, that isn't represented necessarily on this chart, please do reach out to CELA, as we might also work with other organizations that you can work with. I will also say that many of the opportunities that get posted, or at least some of them, do have a remote component, in which case you might not necessarily need to live in the state in order to help on the case. So you can look out for that as well. This is an example of what the case cards look like on our website. As you can see, the case cards tend to have kind of a general description of the case, and it can be kind of a specific case in terms of like helping a particular client with their particular case, or it might be a general topic like drafting declarations for asylum or something like that. If you're just interested in a general topic area, and the organizations often just have such a high need that they can usually place a case pretty quickly if somebody does express an interest in working on a particular type of relief. We also like to highlight in the case cards the geographic information about the case, and then they will provide a little bit of a description of what it entails. The description oftentimes might say too, if there is a language, if the client speaks a different language, and a lot of times the organizations might be able to provide interpretation services, or there might be other ways to work through that in order to connect the volunteers and help them with translation or interpretation services as needed. You can filter the case cards on the CELA platform. There is a search bar that you can keyword search, and there's also a number of ways to filter. You can do it by partners, which this slide has highlighted, which basically means the organizations that I showed on the last slide. You can also do it by subject matter area. And then also if you're looking for certain things like mentorship, that's another way you can do it as well. If you do see a case card that you're interested in, it is very easy to express your interest. As highlighted on this slide, there is a little icon at the bottom of every case card that says interested. When you click it, it will show a place for you to enter. It will ask for the things on the screen here, which do include things like your bar number or comment, but the only mandatory information would be a name, email address, and phone number. When it's submitted, it should go directly to the organization that posted the case card. And from there, they will reach out to you. We do say at CELA that if for some reason you have submitted a case card and you don't hear back from the organization in a few days, please do reach out to us as well, as we're happy to help facilitate that. But the organizations we work with are great, and they tend to be very responsive as well. There, if you are also looking at the website and looking for a particular type of case, maybe in a particular area or a particular country of origin or something like that, you can set up notifications if you don't see a case card that you immediately are interested in, but you certainly want to look for a case in the future. And this slide has some information about how to do that. It's pretty straightforward. In the search area, which was highlighted a couple slides ago and is also shown on here, there will be an option when you do a particular search to sign up for notifications, where you can enter your email and then click sign up. And when you do that, you should be notified for any future postings that will kind of meet the criteria that you've set up there. And we hope too that in addition to looking for yourself, you will possibly look for others. You know, if you have other colleagues, or, you know, if you think that this might be something that somebody else you know might be interested in, you can certainly share a case card. That is the icon on every case card in the bottom right. If you click it, it will show a URL. And if you copy and paste it, it is unique to each case card. And so you can email it, or I guess text it. And that will be sharing the opportunity with others and give them a chance to take a look at it as well. So we're now going to turn to some questions, and I'm going to just kind of take a look to see what's come in here. It looks like we did receive a couple. Thank you so much. I did see that earlier on, I believe in the chat, there was a question about the age when the I-589 application, which is the asylum application, should be filed for an unaccompanied child, and whether it needs to be filed by the time they turn 18. I don't know if that was in reference to a specific case, or if Sachi or Laura had anything you wanted to add to that. I was going to just say, you know, that did remind me, aging out is an issue that we see a lot in this type of work, in terms of what happens if a child is going to turn 18, or in the world of CJIS, as Sachi mentioned, the deadline to file the petition for CJIS is 21. And so there can be issues there, also accompanied with the fact that sometimes obtaining a state court order can become more complicated in particular states by 18. So that is an area where, in particular, we often get a lot of technical assistance requests. So if there is a particular unique issue that might come up in a case, please do feel free to submit one over that. And I'm also turn it over to my colleagues to see if they had anything to add on that at this point.
Yes. So the question was, does the I-589 have to be filed with the asylum office before they turn 18 years old? And it is best practice to file the asylum application with USCIS before age 18, but according to USCIS policy, they must take initial jurisdiction over the asylum application of an individual determined to be an unaccompanied child, unless there's been an affirmative act by HHS, ICE, or CBP to terminate that unaccompanied children finding or status before they filed that asylum application. So that does include even if the child has turned 18 or if they have reunified with parent or legal guardian before filing asylum application, they should still take jurisdiction over that application. But as mentioned, there has been litigation regarding this issue, and I would suggest looking at that National Immigration Project fact sheet that was previously mentioned and shared, because it does get complicated sometimes, and there is a BIA case just to be aware of called Matter of Mako, and that holds that an immigration judge has initial jurisdiction over an asylum application filed by a respondent who was determined to be an unaccompanied child, but who turned 18 before filing the application. So there's a difference, right, between how USCIS looks at it and how the immigration judge looks at it. But because of this litigation, because there's been some positive developments there, even if the judge tries to take over jurisdiction of that application because the child had turned 18, USCIS should not look to that IJ determination. They should still take jurisdiction. So additionally, OPLA should not oppose oppose a continuance based off of USCIS having jurisdiction. They shouldn't advocate for the judge to take jurisdiction. So there's other aspects of litigation too that kind of restrict OPLA and what they can do. So it's really positive development in this regard. It's something to be aware of that it can get complicated, but there are some tools kind of in your toolbox to be able to make the points that you need to for advocacy efforts. And then if possible, just file before 18, because that's the cleanest way, again, best practice.
Thank you, Laura. We also received a question that's a little bit long, but I think my colleague Sachi might have an answer to it. I'm just going to read it out a little bit. Maybe Sachi can provide some context for it, but it has to do with how would an adult benefit or could one person who was in state social service custody from ages 10, almost immediately after entrance to 18, as a result of extreme US citizen parental abuse, and it looks like in this case it was entered in the US on a B2 visa, and then the family did not apply petition for any immigration. And I will once again put a plug in that if for some reason we're not able to kind of really address the specifics of this, you're welcome to submit a technical assistance request. But I didn't know if Sacha, you had some additional follow-up you wanted to discuss here as well.
It'd be a couple of options, actually. Of course, we don't know all the facts of the situation or where this person is living, what their state law could be, and we don't know their age. But depending on their age and what their state law is, some states do allow SIJS, the state court orders. They have post-18 orders. So if they are over 18, SIJS could be an option if they are in a state that allows the post-18 orders. But if they are under 18, there's also a SIJS, depending on their state, of course. And VAWA, the Violence Against Women Act, is a form of humanitarian relief. We do not see it often in children's work, but it is applicable. And it applies when there is a US citizen or LPR parent or spouse and that involved when abuse was in the situation, that could apply. Also, a U visa could apply if the child or the individual did cooperate with law enforcement or is willing to cooperate with law enforcement. Of course, we don't have all the facts of the situation. There may be a couple of options, just depends on the location, what the laws are. And so feel free to send us a technical assistance quest. We'd love to dive into it further.
Thank you, Sachi. We've received a couple more questions. Thank you. We'll try to get to them all in our remaining 5 minutes here. One of them has to do with where the children are coming from and the percentage of them that might be of African descent. I believe, Laura, were you able to, do you have some information about that?
Well, I'll tell you what I can tell you, basically. And so majority of unaccompanied children do migrate from Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, and kind of the percentages that we have on that is in the majority from Guatemala, 47% of unaccompanied children migrate from Guatemala, 29% from Honduras, and 13% from El Salvador, and 11% from other. So I can't specifically answer the question because that's kind of in terms of where I know to look from data, which I'm getting this from ORR, that's how they group it. And so you're right in that children are migrating from many countries from around the world, but that's where we see the most children migrating from. And I will also note just, over the last year or two, there's additionally been a significant number of children migrating from Afghanistan and Ukraine as well. And I'll put a couple of links in the Q&A function just so you can see where I'm pulling those particular data points from.
Great, thank you. There was also a question about possible consequences for a minor who would be released to an undocumented parent in Florida after the new immigration plans. I don't know if it's possible, we might be running out a little bit of time to provide context, if you're referring to necessarily the new policies. For those who may be following the news, the immigration world, there has been a lot in the news talking about the end of certain policies called Title 42 and what that's going to mean and new policies that are going to be in place. I will know, a lot of those policies, unaccompanied children, they don't necessarily apply to them in the same way as they might necessarily do to others. But of course, that's kind of a general sweeping statement. It would need to be looked at a little more closely. And so if you do have a specific case in mind, please do reach out to us and are concerned about a particular issue. I think that might be the best way to handle that at this point. Unless any of my other colleagues wanted to weigh in on this issue at this point. Okay, well, I'm sorry, we are running out of time, and I'm not sure if we're gonna be able to touch on every single other question, but I really appreciate them all, and thank you so much for joining us today. Like I said, we are very much available and here to support you at CELA, so we really encourage you to reach out to us, and we love talking to you, and we love, this is what we do. So hopefully we can continue to assist you in this. I did want to leave you with some, if you are kind of interested in just kind of learning more or reading more about unaccompanied children in this world, there's some great books, and there's also a podcast up there that we would encourage you to look into as they provide some personal stories. Some of them are written by folks who are talking about their own experiences traveling to the United States. And they're also just kind of great stories for understanding the context and the world with which we're talking about here. As I have been kind of repeating throughout, we do a lot of technical assistance at CELA, and we certainly encourage you to reach out to us. Apologies if we were not able to fully answer your question in this particular webinar, but hopefully you can reach out to us afterwards. You'll have my email from when I send the materials, and you can also submit it through the website or through the general inquiry on the CELA at abacela.org. This is just another resource as well for staying in touch with us. CELA does have newsletters. We have monthly newsletters on immigration, children's immigration topics. We also have quarterly newsletters specifically on pro bono work. And you are welcome to sign up for either of those to stay in touch with us and to keep up to date with what's going on. These are, again, other resources and links as well to our website and to the technical assistance. And we are also available in social media. And so please do connect with us, and we hope that you stay in touch. And we really thank you so much for attending today. And we hope that you will consider or look into working in this area. And thank you again.